John chapter 11. We've arrived in John 11. I've been looking forward to getting to here. Not that I was trying to rush us, as you know. But we're glad to be here. We're going to hopefully get through verses 1 to 16. John, there's the whole account of this funeral, this death and resurrection stuff takes up a whole chapter, and it is a long chapter. There are some 57 verses, so it will take you a few weeks to get through this chapter, not wanting to miss all that it has in it, because it is setting the stage. Remember, we left last week at the end of chapter 10, and that was Jesus kind of finished to his public ministry, is back out where John the Baptist had been baptized, and initially where Jesus was baptized. And while Jesus was out there in this remote place, and so large crowds were coming out to him still, he was teaching, many were coming to believe. And that's when he's going to get word from these two dear sisters about their brother. But it's not by mistake that it's just about Passover time. Jesus was always going to head back to town at that time. You know, we're going to see that all of this is in God's hand, and not by accident, that all of this takes place, and all of it to his glory. So we'll spend some time talking about the sovereignty of God as we go through this as well. But we come to the seventh and final miracle of Jesus recorded by John. This is the last of the signs. We know that one more miracle happened out in the garden that night when Peter whacked off an ear, because Jesus very quietly just puts that ear back on that official. But as far as his signs that John records, he gives us seven I am statements, he gives us seven miracles. This is the last of the miracles. Obviously, Jesus' own resurrection is a huge miracle, but as far as ones Jesus does to declare his divinity, to show and help us to believe that he is who he said he was, is going to happen here. Again, we'll take a few weeks on this. It was about 3 months when we were at the end of chapter 10, remember? It was the Festival of Dedication, or also known as the Festival of Lights, or also known as Hanukkah. So they continue to celebrate that. And so the next feast or festival will again be Passover. It was always God's intent that his son be shown as the perfect Lamb of God, but they lay his life down at Passover. It just brings all the covenants, everything together, all of it right there. And we know that Jesus is the perfect Lamb of God who will lay his life down and be crucified, put to death once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous. Why does it say he did that? It was to bring us to God. Purpose of Jesus laying his life down was to remove the divide, symbolizing the veil torn. We're able to come because we're given Christ's righteousness, only because of his righteousness. Well, has Jesus encountered dead people prior to Lazarus? He has. There's two facts. We have no encounter that Jesus encountered dead people that they didn't come back to life. So I don't know, maybe he went to funeral services and they were just that, but everywhere that we have that he encounters someone who's dead, we have them coming back to life. So nobody should have been shocked. We're going to look at, he raised two people. In Luke 7, 11 to 17, Jesus raised a widow's son in the town of Nain. And in that, don't know much about what happened. It's just all of a sudden, if we read that account, Jesus walks up, the bearers are carrying the boy out. Typically, the day someone died, they were put in the tomb. They were buried. They're not embalming. There's not a coroner's office. There's not a morgue that's kept cold. I mean, they're not taking all the fluids out. I mean, they're just putting spices, wrapping a body, and putting it away. And so Jesus walks up, and the widow's crying, and Jesus stops, and they're just told that he touches and boy comes to life. New plans. Let's get boy down. You bears can set him down. Let's get back to living him life. That's all we get. We don't get what happened before. We don't get what happened after. We just get that Jesus walked by and here was this widow. All that she had left was in this life of her son that Jesus raised. What was the other one? We know Jairus' daughter, right? And kind of a segment of scripture that we get a snapshot of. Literally a couple of days, because he's approached initially by Jairus, and then on the way, what happens? On the way, then the woman with bleeding stops him. But prior to that, we had a calming the storm. We have this whole, then he makes it to the other side, and the man with all the demons comes running. And then when we get to the other side, Jairus comes, all this stuff kind of, we get, most times there's extended periods of time. But in this account that is in Luke 8, is that this carries us right through. But remember, Jairus got news that his daughter was dead. They said, why bother to teach her anything? What did Jesus tell them? Just have faith and believe. And let's go see your daughter. When we got there, people were wailing and mourning. And he says again, she's just sleeping. But they knew she wasn't sleeping. She was dead because they mock and laugh at Jesus. And he only takes the few, the parents and Peter and John up into the room. And what does he say? He tells the little girl to get up. And what does she do? She gets up. Both those cases, though, they had just died. They were younger people. So while this is another, someone's died, it's a little different. Right? So we're going to see some things that happen in this passage that Jesus purposely waits. Although, really, by the time he gets this message, it was likely that Lazarus is already dead. I don't know. There wasn't a time frame for him to have gotten back from getting this message, really, even to have been there while he was still sick. Although that's the part, right? Did the girls believe, sisters believe Jesus could have healed him? Yeah, but now he's dead. And that's a different story. And so we're going to cover, kind of get into all that. What we know heading into our text is that Jesus and his disciples have been out where John the Baptist began his ministry, preparing the way for Jesus. This is where Jesus had been baptized. Jesus has been heading toward Jerusalem for Passover in the near future when he gets a message. Prior to heading out to this region, Jesus had been challenged by the religious leaders if he had not been plain or clear about his identity. We looked at that last week. I told you, you can't hear and understand it because you're not my sheep. My scriptures told him. My works have told him. If you can't believe anything else, then you've got to at least believe my works. And while John only gives us seven, we know there were a whole lot more, right? We've got plenty in the other Gospels, and we're told there were plenty that didn't even get recorded. He's healed and healed and healed, and he's taught and taught and taught, and so many things have gone on. But by the end of chapter 10, Jesus has given sign, by the end of this chapter 11, Jesus will have given sign of all signs, and yet still many will not believe. And Jesus even said at one point, he was asked, just give us another sign. And Jesus said, even if I raise someone from the dead, you won't believe. See, that's going to be the case. So is this miracle going to be given to convince his enemies? I mean, if so, that didn't work. I don't think that's the reason. Or was it performed out of compassion for his friends? On the surface, you might say, well, that seems perhaps likely to be why I wait 2 days. I'm just going to spend a few extra days. We're not going just yet. We're going to wait a little longer. He didn't just want Lazarus to be dead. At least Lazarus needed to be dead then. Mm-hmm. It was believed after 3 days that somebody was definitely dead. Well, he will have been in the tomb 4 days. So where decay is begun. So as we progress through this text in the next few weeks, you're going to find the real motive was that God's glory might be revealed. That God's Son may be glorified through it in verse 4. Is that not what God's after all the time? God is to be glorified. So when we make different gods out of ourselves and things, we greatly mess them up. God will get the glory. John records these words inspired by the Holy Spirit as he did the other six signs that we might see Jesus revealed as, and we get to this I am statement in the middle of this chapter. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. We'll ultimately get to another one. I think it's John 14, where it says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Is Jesus an important deal? Yes, he is in every way. It is incidental to this that some believe and that other hearts are hardened. Does Jesus love? Does God so love the world that he sent his Son? Yes, yes, and yes. Yet the message of salvation is less about us and much more about God. So our text, John 11, 1-2, says, Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. We're going to break that up, because what does he just mention? Just mentions the time that Jesus is at dinner. Well, that's going to happen in John chapter 12. Well, wait a minute. You're just identifying Mary for something you haven't told us she's done yet. But when was John written compared to the other Gospels? A whole lot later. This is the last one that comes in. So has it been recorded that Mary anointed Jesus with this perfume? Yes, it has. It's widely known. So he's going to tell us this is the Mary who did this, even though he hasn't specifically told us when that happened, but that's going to happen in chapter 12. But we know that she was the one who took this incredibly expensive perfume, knowing that Jesus was going to die, and had prepared his body by breaking it and literally would get to wiping his feet with her hair. But we're going to look at three characters, three siblings. We're going to begin with Martha, even though she's the one that's mentioned last. It seems the resurrection of Lazarus was a turning point in her life. Thankfully, we know more about Martha than we find right here in John 11. Jesus visited this home, and it's told in Luke 10, 38-42, Jesus had been invited to their house for dinner. We have no mention of Lazarus in that account. But what you will remember is that we do have Mary sitting at Jesus' feet, and Martha being quite upset, but she's running around getting everything ready. So much so that she ultimately tells Jesus, you need to tell her to help me. Get her to help. Can you imagine that? Martha just told the God in the flesh, get my sister off her butt and get her to help. Jesus answers Martha, 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 you're worried about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. Martha's heart to serve was not bad, but here she was worked up to the point of being unkind and looking to have their one guest ignored until it was complete. With that story in mind, we turn to another story in John 12, also found in Matthew 26 and 14. From John 12, which we'll cover in a while, 6 days before Passover, Lazarus, now raised from the dead, there's a dinner in honor of Jesus, and Martha served. But notice two things. First, it was a large party. We have Jesus and all his disciples. So now you got 13. Then we've got this guy, Simon, who had been a leper that was healed. And then you've got Mary, Lazarus, and Martha. Now we have 17 folks. Could have been even bigger. So it's not a small gathering. And the second thing, also notice, Martha is serving, but on this occasion, she doesn't appear to be in the least bit troubled. It's a large crowd. She's not troubled. What made the difference? Her brother Lazarus had been raised from the dead by Jesus. She now sees Jesus in a completely different light. She's learned to take her focus off herself and put it on to Jesus. In the first incident, we notice the pronouns, my and me. Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. She felt unappreciated, neglected, abused, but now after things, she's gotten her mind off of herself and on Jesus. I got to ask us, how are we doing? Day to day, how are we doing with keeping our mind off of ourselves? The things we think we're entitled to that we ought to be getting, and are they on Jesus? When Philippians 2 says that they didn't consider equality with God something to be grasped. Consider others' needs more important than his own. Is that our heart? Or are we much more like Martha? No, Jesus is there, sitting right out in the front room, but we got things that are more important than us. Gosh, everybody's supposed to revolve. This planet, universe revolves around me, don't you know? It's at the core of our sinful nature, each one of us. Somehow, this, everything circles around us. And not something else. Well, the second of these three friends is Lazarus, the man in the tomb at this point of our text. The one Jesus will raise from the dead. By John 12, we see that Lazarus was such a witness for Jesus that the religious leaders want him dead. By the end of chapter 12, we've got to kill Jesus. We need to kill Lazarus too. Why? Because it's become such a testimony. People knew he was dead. They came from all around to see. Now they want to come around to hear. And yet, you know, we have not a single word of Lazarus recorded anywhere. They want him dead for being such a witness, but we don't have a single thing in the person. How can that possibly be? His life, the very fact that he was identified with Jesus. Lazarus is a witness because he was known to be dead. He's now alive. Lazarus was a witness because he identified with Jesus. And in chapter 12, he's at the table with Jesus. He is a part of Jesus' life, identified in resurrection. Were you dead and resurrected by Jesus? Yes, spiritually you were. Paul says in Ephesians 2:1 that we're dead in our sin. By verse 4, God made us alive. If you were his sheep, that is, Jesus performed a resurrection with him. Do you identify yourself openly with the one who performed it as Lazarus did? People see you, do they know that one belongs to Jesus? That one's alive because of Jesus. We so identify with him that people know we're his. And we have a Franklin Graham crusade that was being put on just as I was moving into Greenville. We were there 22 years, but just as we're in this old athletic director, Henry Van Zandt loved him to death, but we got him involved in some Bible study, but he liked to tell the story that when he got involved in this thing, he kept running to people, and he was shocked. I never knew you were a Christian. I never knew you were this. So Henry, how many people were just as shocked when they saw you? Do people know that's who we are? Well, the crusade brought, and whether those people were or not, I don't know, but they were willing to identify it with when it came in, so praise God for that, what it did for a time in that town. But the fact is, do people readily know that's who we are? Well, they knew. A lot of us couldn't have hidden it if he wanted to. He didn't want to. Why would you want to hide the fact that Jesus was the one who called you out of a tomb and you walked out having been dead 4 days? Great news, Lazarus was identified with Jesus at the table that day in chapter 12. We're going to get to do the same thing when we take communion and come to that table today. We identify with Jesus when we remember what he did on our behalf. Why communion is such a vital, important part of the church and who we are. Should every follower of Christ have a verbal witness to be quick to share all that Jesus has done and is doing? Yeah, absolutely. I don't want this to be, well, Lazarus didn't ever have to talk about it. Clearly, he talked about it, and probably gladly talked about it. Again, he was dead. He's alive again. Now, if he had been in heaven and called back, he might not be so excited about it. The fact is, he's there, and I want us to know that we reflect and share all that Jesus' great grace and power is doing in our life. We need to be ready to give an answer to it. Well, the third person we're going to come to is Mary. Every time we see Mary, she's at the feet of Jesus. Even in the resurrection, she recognizes him, thinking he's the gardener. Where does she immediately go to? To her knees at his feet. He tells her she's got to let go of him. He's not yet finished all that he's doing. She's always listening and learning. In this chapter, she expresses her faith. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Did she have any doubt of that? She was absolutely convinced. Jesus, if you've been here, I know you'd have healed him. He'd be here today. In the next chapter, Mary will anoint Jesus' head and feet, and then wipe his feet with her hair. All this time at Jesus' feet appears to have led her to understand that Jesus was going to die for our sin. Seems that Mary understood it and looked for it. Because this perfume put on was to prepare him for the day. Did she believe that he was going to raise 3 days later? Clearly she went to the tomb to prepare a dead body. She brought spices with the other women, so she didn't understand that he was going to raise from the dead. Her sister, we're going to get to, both understood that in the resurrection one day, that he was a part of all that, but they didn't get all of this. The ointment was expensive. We're told she broke the box to get all of it out. She held nothing back. I got to ask this morning, have you given your most precious possessions to Jesus? Have you given your most precious possessions to Jesus? Have you given all of yourself to him? Or is there something you're holding back? Then I've talked to moms and dads. I It's a little scary sometimes in some of the conversations. So one guy, and honestly, I'm going to give his name, was like, if God took my wife, that'd be one thing, but he better not touch my children. Moms, I think they say the same thing. I'm not just throwing dads in the bus there. But there's things that grab our heart that we get misplaced. They're not your children. They're God's children. They're yours to steward, love, and grow them. Absolutely not. But to think that you somehow love them more than God does, that's pretty messed up. Do we trust God to be in control of all things? Or are we still trying to run the universe? Let me make sure that we can somehow guard all things in our kids' lives and that we absolutely can't. Is there anything you're holding back, and why? Is it fear? Is it this or that? We're going to get to some of that. When Mary wiped Christ's feet with her hair, she so identified with Jesus that the smell went through the whole house. Anywhere that Mary went, that smell was going, and that was recognized as what had been poured on Jesus. We become, we're told, the fragrance of Christ. We're the smell of life to some, and we're the stench of death to others. The option we're not given is to be Febreze neutral. You either are fragrance of life, or you're reek of death. If you're not His, you're still dead in your sins, are you not? If you're His, then you've been resurrected and made alive, given a new heart, made new. And you will be appalling. You will reek to those that don't know Christ. They're not going to welcome you with loving arms. This morning in Philippians 1, Paul just said, you're essentially blessed to be persecuted with Jesus, to be so identified with Jesus that the things He went through, you and I should anticipate going through. Again, are we okay with all of that? Are we going to pick up the pace a little bit? Verse 3, so the sisters sent to Him saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. While we've discussed Mary, Martha, Lazarus, and Mary, our current text begins with a problem. Lazarus is sick and dying. It's just pretty straightforward. The sisters simply present the problem. Do you get that? The one, Jesus, the one that you love is sick. He's ill. They don't name it. They don't claim it. They don't speak it into being. They don't tell Jesus what to do or how to do it. Do they? Don't have that at all. They simply say, tell them what the problem is. What is it? The one you love, our brother Lazarus, by the way, this is the ill. Don't miss this. Even those whom Jesus especially loves get sick and eventually die. We're not promised to avoid that. We're not given some. But we don't become the Avengers, some kind of superhero that doesn't go through physical sickness, death, and pain. We are still His creation, and this is still temporary. When the sisters approached Jesus, they did so on the basis of His, that being Jesus' love for Lazarus. They love Jesus, obviously. We hear that Martha, Mary, and Lazarus love Jesus. But His love for them is even greater. They're not appealing based on their love. They're appealing based on His love. Which love saves? Did your love save you, or did Jesus' love for you save you? His love for you saved you. While we're yet sinners, Christ died for us and loved us. If it's about ours, then we got to constantly wonder, did I come up with enough? Did I muster up enough? Did it not happen because I didn't do enough? It was never about you. It's never about your effort. It's always about His. We respond to what He has done. And we get that mixed up and back and forth a bunch. Paul said Lazarus was sick and failed. The Greek word that John uses here implies that he was deathly sick or sinking. And although many teach today that God would not have any of His be sick, it's just not good. It's just, we know it's not. Yep. People are flocking today to go into churches to hear men and women tell them that lie. God would only have you to be healthy and wealthy. never sin. You just got to claim it. You just got to speak it. You just got to believe it. It's not what we have. Charles Spurgeon wrote, "The love of Jesus does not separate us from the common necessities and infirmities of human life. Men of God are still men. The covenant of grace is not a charter of exemption from consumption or rheumatism or asthma. Don't be surprised when we or those we love suffer." Can we pray for healing? Yes. Is God still healed? Yes. There isn't a guarantee and a promise? No, it's not. God will use those very things to grab hold of us. I told you my coaching friend with ALS considered ALS a blessing because it threw him into the arms of Jesus. Did God heal him? Spiritually, yes, in every way. Physically, no, his body went down that path and ultimately he had to turn off a vent. Even then, my heart was slow to quit. And we went to be with Jesus. God is sovereign, as we're going to see here. The question is, do we trust Him? Do we trust Him? Do you hold loosely to this life? Or are you clinging on for all your worth? When that day comes, I hope we're ready. Do you believe? Romans 8:28, we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to His purpose. We believe that to be true. The only reason you and I can love God is because He loved us first and did a work in us. It wasn't because you mustered up somehow something more than someone else. It's because He did something to you, gave you a new heart, showed you His love. It's about His love, and that does not look good. These sisters brought the matter to Jesus. Do we act as they did? Is that how we come to Him with our needs and desires and our prayer? Just come to God. We got a problem. It's a problem. I'm sick. I appeal to you. I don't know what you're going to do, but I'll bring it to you. No amount of suddenly work or righteousness you can do to try to get God to do what you want Him to do. Because it was never about your works. It's never about the amount of your work. It was always about His. And then we get that mixed up in a hurry when we're hurting. We begin to question. And I shared about God's sovereignty in another place I had. Men angry at me, expressing anger from others. Don't you dare say that God was behind me. If God's sovereign and controlled, then nothing happens. It's not ultimately that He's allowed to happen. Is God desiring evil things happen? No. Does He allow things to happen? Ultimately, why does anything happen? It is for the glory of God. It's to bring us to Him, that we would glorify God in all that we do. The appeal was to Jesus' love for Lazarus, not their love for Jesus. We get this wrong. We wonder, did I love Him enough? Did I do enough? No, the appeal is to Christ's love, the love of the Good Shepherd. In this, they came seeking the will of Jesus and not their own will. Do our prayers reflect a desire for God's will? Is that how we pray? We come before our Father, that we know love, just that we trust and say, God, I don't know what you want. Bring my heart and mind with yours. But I be in that place of obediently following you, whatever you have in this. So you trust in His love for you and those in your life. Are you aware of Jesus' love for you? I pray that you're in here and this one knows God loves you. There's no question about that or doubts about that. That's all the enemy wants to do is throw doubts in there. Which is why he wants us to think it's about us. No, we won't ever do enough to deserve it. We'll never deserve it or earn it. Do you know this morning that He loves you? Verse 4, but when Jesus heard it, He said, the illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Where else did we see someone that suffered, not as a result of sin, so that Jesus might be glorified? You see that somewhere not long ago? John chapter 9, the man born blind. They asked, do sin cause us? It wasn't anybody's. It's just for God's glory. It's for me to be glorified. Man was blind his whole life just so I could come along at this moment, at this time, and restore his sight. We went through that whole chapter was about him being questioned left and right about what happened, and ultimately becoming a follower of Christ, God being glorified through it. All of this happens. Are we okay when things like that happen? Will sovereign God choose to allow things happen just so he can be glorified? You know, it might hurt us a little bit, feel like it hurts us in the process. It causes us to see him more clearly. Is that not worth anything that we go through? So we're back to this walking with God as God is God, and us to see him clearly. Is that what we really want when we wake each morning? Those are all lists of things we expect him to do to make it go easy and go our way. I got an agenda today, God. And by the way, that universe you think you made, it does revolve around me a bit. Just want you to know, I did these things so that you would do what I want. It's the most absurd thing in the world. That's this Thor's brother in that movie says that's a puny god. claim to be God, and then the Hulk tossed him around. But puny god. Some of us in this world are following a puny god, not the God that's in this book that we have, that we cherish, that brings us truth. God gets to bring about his purposes. Are you okay with that? The reality is Lazarus is likely dead by the time the message gets to Jesus. And by the time we finish this chapter, we'll see Jesus the Father glorified in a whole myriad of ways. It will cause some to believe and it will cause others to be hardened all the more. Same thing happened. Some are going to be hardened by it. Some are going to believe all the more. But both things happen. It will ultimately push those that are hardened to carry out the arrest and the crucifixion of Jesus, which we needed desperately. Verses 5 and 6. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. What? Seems off to us, right? Makes clear Jesus loves him, and yet he's going to stay 2 more days. Seems crazy. I love you guys, so I'm going to delay. Our world would question that love. Why did Jesus wait? What was happening? Where was Jesus? People ministered to, taught, believing. It's what's happening out where he is, right? He's out there, John was baptized. That's still happening. The crowds are still coming, as we're told at the end of chapter 10. They're being taught and they're believing. So it's not like he just took 2 days to go. They really wanted to get a mountain hike in before we went back. It wasn't a distraction. And it wasn't out of indifference. Jesus delays out of love. By the time we finish this, we're going to see what it was in that love. Because they're going to see Jesus ultimately has power over what? Death itself. Is that going to be important for them to know about a week's time after that? Yeah. They're going to watch him die. He's going to be in a tomb 3 days. And the fears they have are ultimately of death in itself. What are most of our fears? Well, it's centered around death in most cases. Jesus delays out of love, not a delay of indifference or preoccupation. It brings about an important lesson. We need to learn to interpret circumstances by the love of Christ and not Christ's love by circumstances. I need to say that again. We need to learn to interpret all of our circumstances by the love of Christ. What am I sure of? I'm sure of the love of Jesus. No doubt about that. Circumstances, I don't know. But I know I can interpret them based on the rock of the love I have of Christ. But it's not the other way down. It's not Christ's love gets determined by my circumstances. Because if it's that way, then I question continually whether he loves me at all. How could I ever question? How could I be Thomas who says, I won't believe till I put my fingers in it? And he shows up and simply sees the scars, he falls to the ground and says, my Lord and my God. What else can he possibly do to show you that he loves you? How would we question that? Yet we have an enemy that does a pretty good job of causing us to question. Verses 7 to 10, then after this he said to his disciples, let us go to Judea. The disciple said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you. And that was just 3 months ago. And are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. Who is the light of this world? Jesus. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him. Time matters. It seems to matter. John is constantly telling us, giving us special so that we know the time frame of it. How many times have we seen Jesus, they're about to stone him, and what happens? It says, and it's not yet time. The hour is not yet. We're getting close in John where the hour is here. We're going to have quite a few chapters that just deal with Jesus' last kind of week, day, literally teaching them that the hour has come. But we are getting to where it's there. We have a sovereign God that works all his purposes in whose time? His time. Do you believe God has your days numbered? Can you do anything to make them longer? Can you do anything to make them shorter? Well, we get the feeling we can, right? The reality is, if he's sovereign, we can't. Even in a case where somebody dies because of something they've kind of inflicted on themselves, God had a number of that. Did God make them do that? No, but God in sovereignty works all things out ultimately. So if I can't do anything to add to them or take them away, should I be afraid of that? Shouldn't be no fear of that at all. There also shouldn't be anxiety. There also shouldn't be a whole daytime or full of things I'm doing to try to make it longer. Which we have folks that will. Then, should I eat healthy? Yeah. Should I probably eat healthier than I do? Probably. But can I waste a lot of time that I would be serving God on looking at every ingredient, everything that I put in my body? Do I ultimately control what that does to me? I've sat with dear friend's doctor and his wife, exercise like nuts, ate all this stuff, all this, and then she ends up with breast cancer. And well, that brought them to Jesus, so that was all a blessing in the end. But they're asking themselves, this isn't supposed to happen to us. Welcome to the world. It's sinful and broken. There's only one God, and he's in charge of all things, and he's just worked that together for your good. Ultimately, for your eternal good and to his glory, that you now have this testimony of how God caught it and caught it in a freak way, and something else was being check because she had a baby not long ago. If it weren't for that, they wouldn't have found it. And then, so yes, God's hand's all over it. It's always all over it. Do we live in our fears of all of it? I have an absolute assurance that I can't add to or take away. God's going to take me today. And I can remember getting on airplanes with football players who had never flown, and they were definitely afraid. One guy that ultimately came to Jesus, our sports information director, Tom, love Tom, he said, he got on the plane, said, I'm so glad Chuck's on the plane. I couldn't help it. I said, I can't wait to see Jesus. Which always made him quite uncomfortable. You know, we're going to go, whether I'm at home in bed watching the game on my couch, or I'm in this plane going with you guys out to watch it on your sideline, that's going to bring me home. I'm not in more danger because I'm on the plane with you guys. And I'm also not going to rob him of bringing me to be in his presence by thinking I can protect myself and avoid all these dangers. But we can't avoid them. So we ought to be the freest people out there when it comes to our fears and anxieties on those things. Do we trust and believe? Do we live for Christ to avoid danger? What are you doing with your time? Is your life illuminated by Jesus, the light of the world? Do you live a freer, different life than those that don't know Jesus? Because the light of the world illuminates your way. So that you and I shouldn't stumble. You shouldn't be falling all over the place. We still need to grow. Yes, we're still being sanctified. But we ought to be walking down life with a much freer, clearer path than those that don't know Jesus. Sometimes I guess I'm not sure what we do. Sometimes I think we're I don't have to say it other than we're lazy with the truth it's in. We've read it, we know what it says, but it's yet to penetrate to connect the dots between just being some knowledge and that being what we truly live on. I've read it, I know it to be true, but it's got to move through the spirit to my heart that it affects and guides my feet, my steps, and my actions, and how I go about it. Otherwise, you're a player on the field that maybe scored on you because you didn't do your job, and you go, my bad. Guess what, Johnny? All of us at your staff know it was your bad. 50,000 people in the stands know it was your bad. This didn't bring any comfort to your teammates. What we need to know is that next time, you will actually do what you know. And you'll live by what you know. Then we can rest in doing our job knowing that we'll do your job. Christ has done the work for us. Do we believe it? Verses 11 to 15. After saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. Yeah, I'm trying to give the disciples some credit here, because I don't think that would have been any different. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he's fallen asleep, he'll recover. Sleep's a pretty good thing. It refreshes you, it renews you. Like, wish I could go to sleep. Now, Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest and sleep. So in verse 14, then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died. And we get this verse in 15. And for your sake, I am glad that I was not there. Again, we go, what? And he says, why though? So that you may believe, but let us go to Lazarus has died, and for your sake, I am glad. Wow. That was my coach saying to ALS. I was like, huh? We understand what it brought about. Okay, yes, I agree wholeheartedly. Firstly, do any of us want to skip or avoid physical death? When the reality is the bigger concern is what? Spiritual death. Hold up less about our bodies in this place. This group has had a good bit of the physical death. You all's family, and your wife, all your family, and your favorite family, and there's been others. There's been a lot of all ages, and of all different people. Boy that lived with me, no longer here. And he didn't know Jesus. And that actually kills my heart. And we've got an uncle of Lisa's that just passed. He didn't know Jesus. There's other family members you know that don't know Jesus, and that just gets difficult. The bigger concern is the spiritual death that we all start out with. Jesus is glad because he knows what is coming. If we belong to Jesus, we know what is coming. Do we get death has no power with Jesus? That's such a blessing for those that are sure. It should have lost all its sting by now. The question is, if you're one of the sheep, if so, what are you doing with the time that you have? Are we truly putting in and sharing the hope we have with everybody we can share? Are you walking with Jesus? Are you living as a person that's resurrected from the spiritually dead? When we get that way, we wake up knowing I've been raised from the dead. I'm alive. I was dead and now I'm alive. What a jump on our steps, you know. That ought to drive me quickly to here and on my knees and let's go, what do you have? Can't wait to do your will today. Let's shake it up. Whatever you have. Are you walking with Jesus? Are you living as a person resurrected from the spiritually dead? Now I gotta implore us and urge us in every way that be who we are. Well, verse 16, we'll wrap up today. So Thomas called the twin. So he has a twin we never hear about. Could have been an identical twin. Could have been a sister. Could have been, but we know he's a twin. We don't know if she ever came to follow Jesus. We just know Thomas. Thomas gets a bad rap because he's called Doubting Thomas. I think we all need a little bit more of Thomas in this. But he says this. Said to his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Because it started, remember, Jesus, you're going back where they wanted to kill you last time. I was like, here we go. Let's go, guys. Not exactly the most fun-filled statement. Seems a little gloomy. Seems a little defeatist. But is he not ready to follow Jesus? Like, he knows it's dangerous. He knows what's coming. Yet he says, guys, let's go. I don't know exactly the tone I should read it with, whether it's enthusiastic or whether it's Eeyore and gloom and doom, but he's planning on following Jesus. He's not going to stop following him. He's not the one who denies him 3 times. He's not the one who betrays him. He just simply makes this statement. Jesus invites us to do what? To deny ourselves, pick up a cross, and follow. Is there not an element that we realize that I'm giving up this flesh and this life here? Romans 6, we read in verse 5, for we have been united with him in a death like his. We shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Romans 6, 6 says, we know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. Isn't this close? This physical life and flesh, we need to see this give off. Done away with, so that we can live this new resurrected life. So I'm asking, are we living the fleshly life we've always lived, or are we living in Christ in this new life in him, in our spirit, with the flesh we put to death? Also says in Galatians 2:20, I've been crucified with Christ. That's just the beginning part of that verse. Later on, Galatians 6:14 says, but far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. Those are verses I know you've heard before when we've read again. Do I actually live them? Do I actually live with the understanding I've been crucified to this world? I've died to this world. Have we died to this world? Is that simply a slogan and stick posts? Do I live a new resurrected life in Christ? Fully and only on him. Lord, again, the things of this world just quickly flood all that out. Our life in Christ begins with the call of Thomas. Let's go with him, and we may die with him. Because we also, if we die with him, we live with him. We don't live with him unless we die with him. That's what it says. I got plenty that want both. No, I want to live for me and live for him. It doesn't work that way. We don't live with him until we die with him. What all does that look like? Are you willing to follow Jesus and die into this world in this flesh? Are you ready to live a life in the power of the resurrection? Maybe. Here we are. But we're going to continue to go through this and see all that he does in this passage. We get to the privilege of identifying with Jesus and remembering his death and his resurrection by going to communion and coming to this place. If I can, if we can hit that red button, and we're going to get this crowd.